came here to test technology, to further understanding of hydrothermal systems at the seafloor, and we came here to merge all of those things together. Normally, you're often just lost and blind at the bottom of the ocean. Because we had the maps and because we had the synthetic aperture sonar, we were able to drive with pinpoint accuracy to all the various spots we wanted to go. When you drive up to a vent with the ROV, you know, everything's dark, but as you get closer, things start to slowly illuminate. And the first thing you always see when you approach a hydrothermal vent is the bacterial mats. And I'm like, got it. Just like that. And we found, seven or eight actively venting complexes, towers 10, 12, 15 meters tall. The highest temperature was over 250 degrees, and tube worms and all of the animals. And to me, that really validated our approach. A good example of the technology is one of the sites we went to. We had the ship-based bathymetry, so we knew that this was a place that was likely hydrothermally active, but no one had ever discovered any venting at this site before. So we went down with the ROV and we mapped with the M3, and right away we saw indications that's probably where there's some hydrothermal vents. We can now see if a vent is active or inactive simply from the SAS data. Knowing the texture of the seafloor, that'll give you information on what types of animals can live there. So this could really change our understanding of, you know, distributions of different animals or how ecosystems function, those sorts of things. We're the first ones to really try this using the SAS as an exploration tool. So what can you see with SAS, synthetic aperture sonar, that you don't see with regular sonar systems? It's just more detail.
Seeing the black smoker on the SAS image, I think no one expected to see that. That's something that's unique. So I think this is a great advance that we got.
I've been in the business for 30 years and have been exploring the ocean floor for precisely these sorts of environments for 30 years. And in the early days, we would spend weeks upon weeks hoping that we might encounter just one site. And what InSAS has done for us and also the M3 multi-beam mapping has allowed us to identify the targets before we even go into the water. Now that we know we can do this, there's no going back. Well, it was a spectacular success from a technological point of view. We would have discovered the value of InSAS and the M3 high-resolution mapping, whether there were hydrothermal vents or not. It's just that we got the double benefit of having this technology in the right place at the right time to be able to discover the hydrothermal activity that we did.
A large part of this cruise is using what we call active acoustics, which send out acoustic signals and they listen to the response that comes back. But we also have the deep acoustic lander, which is what I'm working with. And that's a passive acoustic instrument that just listens. We're just trying to understand the natural soundscape. If we can understand the acoustic source mechanisms and tie that to the flow rate or temperature and other properties of the vent, then we can use passive acoustics to monitor them geologically. I've only done very kind of preliminary analysis, but that's kind of pointing in the direction of some interesting signals from the black smoker high temperature sites.
¿Cómo esto favorece a Ecuador, a Galápagos y al Pacífico Este tropical? Si nosotros adquirimos el conocimiento de los ecosistemas de profundidad, tenemos más argumentos para ayudar a la conservación no únicamente de una isla, pero de una región de extrema importancia, que es el Pacífico Este tropical.
What is the driver to get us to see? Somehow there's something about going into another world that is truly exhilarating. It's a world we don't belong in, and yet you realize how connected you are to it. We need to care about every part, from top to bottom, from what's happening in the atmosphere, what we're doing on land, how we affect the deep ocean, and how the deep ocean affects us, which it does. Keeping those connections safe is what will keep us alive on this planet.